slowly there.
I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord.
Power and his grace.
seated. As we read together today's opening prayer as printed in our bulletin. Holy One, God of all creation, you call us to be your people, to carry vision in this time and place, to go where you send us, to help welcome your amazing good news. As we gather in the presence of the risen Christ to spread the news that your realm is near, fill us with your Holy Spirit, O God of all creation. Fill us with your glorious Spirit, that we may share your good news with the world in need. Amen. Now, let us take a few moments for personal prayer and meditation. Only trust him. Thanks be to God who knows our every need. Amen.
Thank you.
please stand if you're able. After that rouser, let us boldly proclaim what we believe in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Lord be with you. Let us be seated as we pray together. Lord God, here we are with our heads bowed. We're wanting to humble our hearts as our spirits stand before you. Our Savior Christ, you died for us. You crushed Satan. You broke his authority. You have given us power to reject him. You have told us to come before you boldly, looking for and expecting you to answer our prayers. There are many needs here this morning, Jesus. Some prayers are for healing and some are for relationships. Some are for children and some are for finances. Some are for jobs. Jesus, you know us all. You know the number of hairs on our heads. You already know our needs. So please satisfy our prayers and give us wisdom and teach us what it is you want us to learn. Change us to always have a desire to be in your will. For that is the safest place in the universe. Lead us as individuals and as a church to do good as often as we can, as that is always your will. Lead us now in that prayer that you taught your disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning again, and I'd like to share with you a couple of announcements. This Sunday, we were supposed to have the new pulpit and lectern and altar, but like all custom furniture, it didn't make it on time. And so we pray that it will be here next Sunday. So pray. Also, tomorrow is Sunny Monday, and we will have Kathy McCullough from the new Family Y sharing with the seniors all of the wonderful information and adventures that they can be involved with there. Please note all of the other announcements in the bulletin, and I know you will pay attention where you have interest. At this time, we invite the ushers to come forward. to receive your tithes and your offerings. And as they come, please remember the ritual of friendship pad located on the center aisle. Please register your presence. Pass it down the aisle so your neighbor can sign it as well. We invite the children to stay. Do not leave during the singing of this next hymn, because we want you to remain for the reading of Scripture that is very special, and we know the children will not want to miss that. And then we will have opportunity for you to leave and to go to Children's Church. So let's all stand and sing, remain standing and sing our next hymn, Depth of Mercy.
One day, God spoke to a man named Jonah. Jonah heard the Lord and answered. God told Jonah to arise and go to the city of Nineveh and to tell the people there to repent of their evil ways. But Jonah couldn't believe God wanted him to go to that awful city. So he asked God, and God answered. But Jonah didn't want to go to Nineveh, and he said to himself, so Jonah fled from the Lord and went down to Joppa and got on a ship going to Tarshish. But the Lord saw Jonah, and he hurled a mighty wind onto the sea. The wind became a fearsome storm, and the ship was in trouble. The sailors became frightened and began throwing cargo off the ship to lighten the load. They cried out to their gods, but no help came. Finally, the captain woke Jonah. He had been sleeping even in the storm. Jonah knew that he had caused the storm by being disobedient to God, so he told the sailors to throw him overboard into the sea and the storm would stop. The sailors were afraid to throw Jonah into the sea, but at last they had to. And down into the stormy water Jonah went. Then at the bottom of the sea, a great big whale swallowed Jonah. I don't know if you've ever been in the belly of a whale, but it's an awful cold, damp, wet, and smelly place to be. However, Jonah knew God had saved his life, and so Jonah prayed and asked for forgiveness for running away from the Lord's command to go to Nineveh. Then the Lord commanded the whale to spit Jonah out onto the shore. Then God spoke to Jonah a second time. And Jonah answered. Then God told Jonah, "Arise, go to Nineveh, and proclaim the message I will give you." And this time Jonah said. So Jonah obeyed God and went to Nineveh, the great city. It took Jonah 3 days to walk through the city, and as he walked, he cried out, "In 40 days, Nineveh will be overthrown if the people do not repent from their wicked ways and turn to the one true God." The people of the city heard, and from the king on down, they all repented from their sins and worshiped God. And Jonah learned a lesson we should all know. It's foolish to try to run away from God. Instead, it's best to walk with him, and he will do mighty things through us. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Handbell Choir. This time we invite our children to follow the crucifer to children's worship. Jonah is a small book about 2 pages long that is often criticized by scholars and skeptics. For some, the book of Jonah is a fishy tale. Sorry, my pun. That is terribly unreliable. A man swallowed by a big fish and live 3 days in the belly of that fish. It's impossible. It's unreliable. But Jesus also told stories and parables, like the prodigal son, that may not have been literally true, but revealed the very heart of God. And the book of Jonah not only reveals the heart of God, but I think of all the books in all of the Bible, it most clearly reveals our human nature. Terry Fleming was the director of Christian education here at St. John's 7 years ago. One day we were talking and he said to me, "You know, God called me to preach when I was a young boy. And I ran from it. I resisted it. I thought if I worked in the church, participated in the church, became a Christian education director, that the call would go away. But it never has. Even today, I wonder if I should answer that call." Now, I responded to him rather glibly and without thinking, and I looked at him and said, "Why are you wasting God's time? If God called you to preach, you'll never be happy, you'll never be fulfilled, and you'll never have any purpose." So 4 years ago, he was appointed as the minister of a church in Ellery, South Carolina, and another close to Santee. And I want you to know that this coming May, he will graduate from Southern Lutheran Seminary. And I want you to know that I understand the sacrifices he and his family had to make for him to accept those two small churches and to work so hard and diligently to get through seminary. I also want you to know that this past week at the Board of Ordained Ministry, there were about 28 potential candidates coming before that board. And they were all trembling. Terry Fleming was one of eight who passed all four committees. I also want you to know that this coming June, that he will be ordained as a probationary elder in the United Methodist Church. And I know that all of you will join me in saying how proud we are of Terry. The word of the Lord came to Jonah and said, "I want you to go to Nineveh and cry out against those people. Tell them if they don't repent, if they don't turn from their wrong doings and from their evil ways, that they will feel the full fury and wrath of God upon them." There was just one problem. Jonah didn't want to go. And I want you to know there was good reason for him not wanting to go. They were the Ninevites. Ninevite was the capital of Syria. Assyria. Assyria was a large, politically powerful country. In fact, it was Assyria that invaded Israel and had captured the 10 northern tribes of Israel, taken all of the people away, destroyed their homes, and made them slaves to the Assyrian people. Some of those 10 tribes were family members of the two tribes that were left. So now you're beginning to understand the anger and the hatred that Jonah and Israel had for the Ninevites. It's a little bit like Canada. Imagine if you would, it's a hard imagination, but imagine if you would that Canada was a big political power. And they invaded the United States of America. And they captured all of the states except for South Carolina, Georgia, and Florida. And I know many of you have family living in other states. And not only did Canada invade us, but they captured all of the people and took them back to Canada to serve as slaves, to work in their factories and in their homes. And you could no longer talk to them. You could no longer see them. How would you feel about the Canadians? The same way Jonah felt about the Ninevites. He hated and he despised the Ninevites, and he couldn't believe that God wanted to send a prophet to talk to those evil people. And so what does he do? He runs away because he didn't want to go. Curtis was a member of my first church in Bishopville. Every Sunday after church, I would stand at the door and greet people. Curtis would come by. He was there every Sunday. I would extend my hand in his handshake, and I would say, "Good morning, Curtis." He would turn his head and ignore my handshake and walk right by. And I didn't understand. As far as I knew, we never had a disagreement. We never had cross words. We never disagreed about anything. And so I asked some members of the church, "Tell me about Curtis." They said, "Oh, he's strange. Don't pay any attention to him." Well, he did that for 3 years. And then one day I received a telephone call. Curtis had had a heart attack. And his family didn't know if he was going to make it. His very life was in the balance. And his wife was calling for me to come. And I immediately went. And there she sat outside of intensive care. I prayed for her, and then she said, "I know Curtis would want you to pray for him. Would you go inside and pray for Curtis?" And right there, in the middle of that huge crisis, I had to tell her, "I don't think Curtis wants me to go in and pray for him." And she said, "Oh, I know he would." And so, against my better judgment, I went into the emergency room. And when he saw me, he turned the other way, turned over, and mumbled, "I'm tired." And so I very quickly said, "Okay." It wasn't about my rejection then. I didn't want to do anything that would perhaps take his life. And so I left, and I told his wife what happened. Well, a few days later, they stabilized him, moved him to Columbia. He improved so much, they put him in a private room. And God spoke to me, or God spoke to my conscience, and said, "Go." And I said, "God, he doesn't want me to go. He doesn't even like me. And I don't want to do anything to hurt him." And God said, "Go." And so very reluctantly I went. And when I walked into the room, I had the same cold reception. And so I dropped all guards and pretense, and I said, "Curtis, what's wrong? What's wrong between you and me? Have I done anything to offend you? And if I have, is there anything I can do?" And he said, "As a matter of fact, preacher, you can." That's the way he said it. I said, "Anything." He said, "You can call me Mr. "Mr. Curtis, is that what's bothering you that I haven't..." He wasn't that much older than me, that I don't call you Mr. "Is that what's wrong?" And then he told me the real story. Before Pam and I were married, the three little churches threw a shower for her. And we received a wedding gift from his mother, Miss Callie. Well, when Pam received the note, she didn't know if Callie was a man or a woman. And so she addressed the thank you card with Callie. And I quickly apologized and told him what happened. And an amazing thing happened. For the first time in 3 years, he reached out his hand and we prayed together. When I walked out of the room, I said to myself, and I didn't even want to go. Sometimes God calls us to places that we don't want to go. And Jonah didn't want to go to Nineveh. In fact, he headed in the opposite direction towards Tarshish. And there on the sea, God sent a great storm to where the boat was about to sink. And Jonah discerned that this was punishment against him for running away from the presence of God. Folks, you can't run from God. And you can't hide from His presence. From a far distance, on the sea, or under the sea, God will find you. And so he let the sailors on board throw him overboard. And he was ready because he knew that he had disappointed God and his life wasn't worth a plug nickel. But God sent this big fish, swallowed him whole. And it took Jonah 3 days, my friends. 3 days, think about it, in the belly of a fish to say and to pray these words. Now, this is paraphrased. This is my words. But this is about what he said. God, forgive me for my arrogance, for following what I wanted to do and not what you wanted to do with my life. God, forgive me. Because I thought you were wrong and I was right. And God forgave him and threw him up on dry ground. And God came to him a second time. Aren't you glad that God is a God of the second chance? What do we do with our failed leaders? Well, I know what we do in the church. If they do some great public sin, we kick them out. And we tell them, you're no longer worthy to lead in the church. Don't we? We don't give them a second chance. But God is a God of the second chance. Think about King David. King David had an affair with another man's wife. Even had the husband killed to cover up his sin. Would you have given him a second chance? I doubt if I would have. But God did. God forgave him and he became the greatest king of Israel. In fact, today we call him a man after God's own heart. And how about Simon Peter? You know, who boastfully said, Lord, I'll never desert you, even if I have to die for you. I'll never leave you. But when it came down to that very moment, not only was he unwilling to die for Jesus, he very quickly denied even knowing him. And he ran away like a coward, weeping in the night. Would you have forgiven Peter? Jesus did. And he became the leader of the church. Aren't you glad that God is a God of the second chance? And that He forgives us when we fail? And God came to him a second time and said, now I want you to go to Nineveh. This time I want you to proclaim the message that I will give you. And Jonah goes. Now Nineveh was a large city. It took 3 days to walk through it. And Jonah makes his way a day's journey into the city. And then he begins preaching. Now, you would think that he would love to be there by now. I mean, after all, this man has survived living in the belly of a fish. God saved him. God forgave him. But no. He couldn't get over his anger and his hatred and his bitterness for the Ninevites. And he started preaching. And this is what he said. And I think this is the way he said it too. Not in judgmental or anger or loud Baptist voice. No. This is the way he said it. Folks, you've got 40 days. And God will destroy you. And he preached that for 3 days. Now, usually preachers are long-winded and they aren't short of words. You know, they preach these long, boring sermons that you wish they would just... No, his was one sentence. You've got 40 days before God destroys you. This is it. But an amazing thing happened. He didn't even want them to believe it. An amazing thing happened from the king to every man, every woman, every child. Even the animals started fasting. Just in case God would change his mind. After the 40 days, Jonah went out on the hillside overlooking Nineveh, crossed his arms, and he was waiting for God to destroy him. And then God came to him and made a great announcement. Jonah, I've changed my mind. Wait a minute, God, you can't change your mind. See, that's the most difficult thing about this story. God changed his mind. And God said, when I saw these people and how they repented and put on sackcloth and turned to me, I have changed my mind and I'm going to forgive them. And Jonah said, Lord, I knew you were going to do that. That's why I didn't want to come in the first place. I knew that you were merciful and kind and generous and forgiving. God, I want you to destroy these people. I hate them. Don't you know just how bad and awful and terrible they really are? They deserve to be wiped off the face of the earth. You ever got mad like that at God? Sure you have. Sure you have. It's like that story of the prodigal son. We're like the older brother. You know, when that younger son comes back after wasting his life and spending his father's money and throwing away his inheritance, taking his father's heart, throwing it on the ground, and then just rubbing it in his face. We're like that older brother. He doesn't deserve a party. And what does the father do? He puts a ring on his finger and shoes on his feet and he puts on this real fancy robe and throws him a fire. No, he doesn't deserve it. He shouldn't be forgiven. You ever felt that way? Well, you know, in this city we have lost 2 police officers and just a little over a month. And I was interested this past week in reading Talk Back and all of those things. And I heard comments like the city should do something. That we're no longer safe and that we're afraid and that we're frightened. And you saw those who have committed such a heinous crime. And we don't want forgiveness. We know what they deserve, don't we? Sandy Rogers was a member of this church. Mr. Jack? Sandy wouldn't want us to retreat in fear and anger and vengeance. No. No, that's not going to make us any better. Have you ever found yourself so angry, so mad at someone, you just could never, ever forgive them? There's a man by the name of Karl Barth who said, when you look at somebody with that kind of vengeance and hatred, you're really looking at yourself. Because you know that when you talk about them that way, they don't deserve to be forgiven. Deep down, you realize you don't either. So you have to be careful. You see, this God is an amazing God we serve. When he was dying on the cross, what did he say to those who nailed him there? Forgive them. The very ones that laughed at him, mocked him, scourged him, beat him, nailed him at the tree. And do you know what else? They didn't even ask for forgiveness. Of course they didn't deserve it. And they didn't even ask for it. And God's radical love and forgiveness gave it to them. In fact, they had the attitude of this smirk on their face that they had done the right thing. Let me tell you, God has called us to a radical ministry of grace. He's called us to go and to love others as he has loved us. You see, that's what's going to change our hearts. That's what's going to change our church. That's what's going to change our community. And that's what's going to change our world. An extravagant, radical grace that loves a sinner just like me. Francis Osteen is about to leave Tuesday to go to Kenya. And Frances and John's going to join her in a couple of weeks. She's not going for a week or two. She's going for an entire month. Frances, this church today commissions you to go in grace, that the children you minister to will see God's love. They may not deserve it. Their parents certainly didn't deserve it. And we wonder what a little bit of grace is going to do in that part of the world. Oh, it can change that part of the world. And I'm going to ask now that you and John come forward. As God has called all of us to go and to live lives of radical grace, of love and kindness, mercy and forgiveness, we're going to send you forth in that kind of radical grace. Just at Christmas, a guard was killed at Children's of Life Ministry. Francis, why in the world would you want to go? She said, because that's where God called us to go. Would you put out your hands? Dear God, we ask for anointing of grace on these two, that as you send them, that they will go with your grace, your kindness, your love, and your mercy, so that the children that are forgotten will know that there is a powerful God that has never forgotten them and will never give up on them. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now I commission you to go and to live lives of radical grace.
Thank you.
Do you know what will change our hearts? Grace. Radical, unbelievable, incredible grace. God, take away all of my anger, all of my judgment, all of my wrath, and let me speak to everyone with kindness and mercy and love and grace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.